Hello YouTube, in this hypertrophy series, I'm going to be detailing what I consider to be the best rep range for hypertrophy. And if you've watched the series and you follow my mindset surrounding programming, you understand that I don't think there exists an hypertrophic rep range, in the sense that anyone who tells you that there is one rep range that builds muscle and the others don't is an idiot. Because as a bodybuilder, you're going to want to use low reps and high reps because they work together. I detailed that in the last episode. So for today, I want to give numbers and I want to explain why I believe this to be the best range. And I'm not the only person who believes it to be the best as well, meaning that a lot of people share my mind. But do they also share the reasoning behind? Let's see, I'm going to explain everything. So for me, the perfect range to work within for bodybuilding purposes and to build muscle mass is going to be 2 to 12. 2 being the lower extreme, 12 being the higher extreme. After that, there is a little bit of a leeway towards the high rep range on that end, and there's no leeway on that side. Why? Because I firmly believe, that one rep maxes, a true 100% exertion is completely useless for bodybuilding. And I'll make a full video about it actually, because it's too long to explain here. But the reasoning is very simple. If you can deadlift, let's say 500 pounds for one, or 490 for two, it's always going to be better to do a set of two. Why? You accumulate almost twice as much tonnage, the control over your form is going to be greater, and the risk of injury therefore is going to be reduced. The only drawback is that one, you're not going to train your ability to do one rep max, which for a bodybuilder is completely useless regardless, and two, you're losing on 10 pounds of quality tonnage, and you're losing therefore on progression, a tiny bit of progression, which is immediately made up by the fact that it's easier to assess recovery with the two reps, even though you do more tonnage, because you are still within an intensity window that is lower. Even though technically the second rep with 490 could also be 100%, but it's a relative intensity, not an absolute one. And that is therefore crucial to me as a bodybuilder. Doing one rep maxes is a waste of time, don't do that. Two is going to be your lower rep range. And even that is going to be a rare occurrence. For me, for example, the only lift where I let myself only do two reps is the deadlift. Why? Because it's a lift that can feed off of intensity extremely well, you don't need a lot of volume, and I have an insane amount of confidence in my form. I know I can push the bell with only two reps, go to almost failure and be fine and encore no risks at all. But there are a lot of lifts that I will never do in a two rep range. For example, squats, bench, never in 1,000 years will I only do two reps. To me, it's worthless. Same for curls or something like a front squat, I never go as low because there is really no use. And in this case, for these types of lifts, I of course go higher. I tend to go for these lifts into a 4 to 8 rep range, meaning that for me, the 2 to 5 rep range is completely depopulated. The only lift that exists in the 2 to 3 to 4 is going to be the deadlift. The 4 marking the entry for the other lifts. So for example, the lower rep range for my squat is going to be 4. Meaning also that when I tell you a 2 to 12, it's a 2 to 12 that you have to adapt to your lifts based on your preferences. Some people will be able to do a 2 rep max on the squat like nothing. It's super easy for them, they control it. But they'll never do it on the deadlift, and that's fine, you just have to adapt. So for me, 4 to 8 is where my strength work occurs, because it is my favorite rep range. Especially when I run it in an evolving rep range scheme, I find it to be the perfect match of volume and intensity. It's low enough that I experiment very heavy weights that challenge me and push me to failure, but it's also flexible enough in the rep range that I can get a lot of reps with that very high intensity, and therefore I get very high quality tonnage. And that is crucial because that's where most of the progression is going to come from. The strength work, not tonnage, not the tonnage accumulated, but the progression that is going to lead to the tonnage accumulation and raise over time. So that, in a sense, is the middle of my bell curve. It's when the amount of lifts represented start to rise. And for bodybuilders, it's going to be skewed towards the higher side of the spectrum. For powerlifters, it's going to be the other way around. meaning that if you look at my representation, if this is 2 reps and this is 12 reps, my bell curve is not right in the middle and it's not skewed towards the left, it's actually skewed towards the right because it starts peaking at 4 reps, but 4 reps is one here, okay? And therefore, it is going to meet its summit around 7-8 reps because at the end of that 4 to 8 reps enters my 2 rep ranges that I use for all of my variations, accessories, pretty much anything I do outside of strength work. And that is going to be 6 to 10, 6 to 12, and 8 to 12. This is the bodybuilding rep range, right? This is what a lot of people say is the hypertrophic rep range. Issue is, if you take the left side of the bell curve I just presented and you cut it, and you just keep everything after 8, look at what you just did. You just destroyed all of the quality tonnage, all of the progression aspect. And now you're just left with the volume. And you're going to be one of those guys that never progressively overloads and that just spins his walls forever because he's doing the bodybuilding reps. But bodybuilding reps, as per the definition, entail that they make you bigger. And if they're lacking the progression intensity aspect, they're never going to be able to do that. So you absolutely want to keep the entire spectrum. Do not shun one side or the other of the spectrum. So for me, the bell curve, as I say, peaks, and most of my lifts happen underneath that 6 to 12. That's where most of the bulk of the program is. And this is where I get my reps. This is where I do my work. And at 12, there is no clear cut, right? I told you that at 2, there is a clear cut. I never go below 2. But I sometimes go above 12. I sometimes go to 15. This is what I would call the junk volume territory. It's when you start getting into rep ranges where you repeat a lift enough times that the amount of reps you had to do to get to failure in the later reps represented an amount of intensity that is so low that it doesn't really matter. And on top of that, it is so low that we could potentially recover within the set, meaning that your baseline, instead of being damaged, manages to recover a tiny bit, a tiny bit, a tiny bit at each rep, meaning that you can grind more reps afterwards. That is the problem with super high reps sets. They don't really give you much valuable intensity at all. They do give you good volume though. But I still always want my sets to take place within something that is relevant. And therefore, my cutoff is 15 reps. When I actually program the lift, I never go higher than 15 reps. And that is only for 4 lifts, meaning that I have 4 lifts in the program that are in the 10 to 15, because I find that they work perfectly well in this aspect. And also that I don't really care about them progressing. This is another aspect of that rep range I just presented. The further right the lift is in the line of specificity, the less of a progression aspect you get. Meaning that if all of your hip hinges are in the higher end of the spectrum, don't expect much progressive overload. You'll get a lot of volume, but the strength progression is going to be slowed down. This is why, if we're again looking at it in the scope of a bell curve, if we're going to put points on that bell curve, we want an even distribution of the points. So for each iteration of a lift, of a movement pattern, and all variations of it, you want to have them spread across. You don't want them all gathered. You need to have lifts that are going to feed progression in lower rep ranges. And you need to have lifts that mimic the movement pattern that are going to have more reps. For example, you do your deadlift, you do them in a low rep, okay? After that, you want a variation, you do remaining deadlift, you do remaining deadlifts in a high rep. Why? Because it makes total sense. It complements each other perfectly, and it's the way you're supposed to go about it. It's the way you're supposed to program. Once you progress, you could find a lift to put in the middle. Okay, what hip hinge could we put in the middle that is not going to be too redundant with the two we already have? Oh, maybe good mornings. Why not good mornings? Good mornings tend to be in the higher rep range. I already have remaining deadlifts for that. Okay, maybe stiff leg deadlifts, maybe deficit deadlifts, those could work. This is the way you need to think about this. A rep range is a tool in reality, it's a bracket. And within the bracket, things happen. What truly matters is not necessarily the bracket, but it's what it's going to actually contour. This is important. The two work hand in hand. You need to think about things like this. So this is my hard cutoff. After 15, there's nothing. Sometimes I'll screw around, I'll do just tricep extensions for 25 reps. But these don't count. I don't know if you've ever heard that saying by Muhammad Ali, who said he never counted the rep. He started counting when they started burning. That is, of course, terrible advice for muscle building because you'll just do junk volume, but it has a certain hidden meaning behind it. And that hidden meaning is that you have to always keep in mind that it is okay to do certain things in higher repetitions just for the burn or the pump, but that it might not necessarily constitute real work. All right, Muhammad Ali was not concerned with building muscles. We are. So you have to pay attention to that. Junk volume is not a bad thing. It's only a bad thing if it replaces quality tonnage that should have occurred in the program. And that, to me, is the perfect bodybuilding rep range, 2 to 12. And I believe that I offered some pretty solid arguments as to why. Going higher is not really going to result in much. Going lower is just going to be a hindrance. You can stay within those range, play with evolving rep ranges, adapt your lifts, and make progress forever. 2 to 12, that's all you need. Thank you for watching. Have a good day.